And I was installing GPS measurements and trying to convince local authorities that earthquake hazard should be higher up on their list. That we were able to provide a likely scenario and that that scenario actually did happen means that probably more attention should be paid to scientists when they talk to authorities about hazards. We are able to measure the position of benchmarks that we install in rocks with a precision of a millimeter. And we repeat those measurements over time. So if those benchmarks move because there is a deformation in the Earth's crust in preparation for an earthquake, then we can see that. If you want to know the probability of an earthquake on a given fault, it's very important to know how fast strain, elastic energy, if you want, is building up on that fault to be released in future earthquake. And that's what we are measuring essentially with this technique. This technique has been out there for about 15 years at the level of precision that we have today. The difference now is that we're able to analyze much more data much more quickly than we were before. So we'll also be remeasuring the benchmark that we have installed in the past on that fault and be able to look at the difference before versus after the earthquake and learn about the mechanics of this particular event. After an earthquake, it takes months, years perhaps, for the whole area of the Earth's crust around the fault, within, say, 100 kilometers around the fault, to fully recover. And this recovery process is very important because it's telling us a lot about the mechanical properties of the Earth's crust. So we have to jump at every opportunity we have to do that. We can only do that when there is an earthquake. It's kind of a laboratory, you know, it's a natural laboratory. So when the earthquake happened, we run out there to be able to measure those mechanical properties, something you cannot do very easily in the lab.